We have done is we talked about 3 out of 5 things that we need to know to do research in quantum optics and quantum information. And then also we started talking about the subject of open system, and we consider kind of a toy model of the qubit interacting with environment. And we consider both kind of fast Markovian interfaces and coherence, as well as non-Markovian case. This is the case when the environment was small. So what I'm planning to do today is I'm planning to give a lecture about quantum information science with atom-like impurities in the solid state. And in particular, I will be talking about color centers in diamond. And I'll also try to cover the remaining 2 out of 5 things that you need to know. And then in the lecture in the evening, we will be all educated and we can fast. So atom-like crystal defects is basically other kind of point defects in wide bandgap materials such as diamond, which are currently explored for a wide variety of applications, ranging from realizing quantum computers to realizing quantum sensors, including all the way in biology. And I will mention a little bit, I'll talk a little bit about those. So the reason why people are interested in this systems is because they are kind of naturally trapped systems. Basically, you know, once they are created in a crystal, they can stay there forever. But at the same time, they, as you will see shortly, they have a lot of properties which make them look very similar to isolated atoms. So they are kind of trapped atoms which are used for research and technology, but they can be used as a kind of solid state realization of isolated atomic model systems. But they also kind of special in that these defects can be localized inside very small physical volume, basically on nanometer scale, and that creates some really new interesting opportunities for both science and applications. So in particular, one can explore new parameter regimes, for example, for realizing hybrid quantum systems, for strong coupling to photons, quanons, and other speeds. But also one can use them for kind of to realize practical applications ranging from quantum information science to kind of novel atomic sensors, to actually exploring quantum dynamics, exploring quantum many-body systems in a new way. So one, so basically, as I said already, I will focus on the atom-like impurities in diamond, and so diamond is a very special host because of some, you know, kind of well-known properties of diamond: its hardness, its wide band gap, and of very good thermal conductivity. So basically, in what follows, I'll be talking about the impurities which can be created either in a kind of single crystal diamond samples, which are very, very pure samples, which basically don't have any defects to begin with, or in this kind of diamond powder, the so-called diamond nanocrystals. And so one example of impurity that I'd like to first focus on is the so-called nitrogen vacancy color center. So this is one of the many stable impurities which are basically frozen in diamond. It consists of nitrogen, which substitutes the carbon atom in the diamond lattice, and vacancy, they kicked out a carbon atom. So these two kind of form a stable, kind of molecular-like system, which for many purposes can be thought as nature's own trapped diamond. So why is that? Well, first of all, it's color center, so it has an optical response, so in particular it has a narrow emission line at 637 nanometers, and one can actually, if you start with the sample which is reasonably pure, one can isolate individual color center by using laser microscopy. So, for example, so this could be this could maybe remind you a little bit the sky here in Arizona, you know, but that's actually not, you know, this is the picture, the kind of scanning confocal microscope image of a reasonably pure, but not too pure, diamond sample. And so these individual dots are actually individual colors and individual impurities which actually fluoresce. And that way we can isolate them individually and control. But then this nitrogen vacancy center also has non-trivial spin properties. In particular, the ground state is a spin triplet. And so this spin then can be manipulated, rotated by radio, by applying radio frequency or microwave pulses, which just arrive with kind of spin transitions and rotate transitions, you know, as we discussed a little bit yesterday. And what's actually particularly special is that even in any air condition at room temperature, these spins have a very long coherence time. They have a coherence time approaching milliseconds, so which is actually kind of very special. So for any solid state system, and in particular for the one under ambient conditions. But last but not least, this nitrogen vacancy centers and other color centers can be actually created on demand in pure diamond crystals. So in particular, the way how one does it is one starts with a pure diamond crystal, and then one bombards them with nitrogen ions. And after basically nitrogen ion goes inside the diamond, it actually creates some damage, it creates some dislocations, and then to release this damage, basically what you do, you anneal the sample at some like 800 degrees. So at this temperature, these kind of dislocations, the vacancies become mobile, they start kind of drifting around, and actually with, you know, pretty high probability, one of them will be captured by nearby nitrogen atom. So that way you can actually create the nitrogen vacancy centers. So this is one of the early attempts to do it, already several years old. So in this case, basically an array of these nitrogen vacancy centers. The goal was to create an array. What you see is that, you know, first of all, like this separation between these centers here is actually quite large, it's like 10 micrometers. So it's actually at this point they wouldn't interact at all with each other. But secondly, also this array, what you can see some period maybe emerging, is for sure not perfect, right? This, there is, you know, there's a lot of dislocation. So this actually maybe a subject of, you know, if I have a little bit of time at the end, about a new work where we're trying to basically learn to control the systems which are disordered, right? Where the spins interact with each other, but they're disordered. And one thing that I should also add is that not only one can do these experiments with nitrogen vacancy centers, but one can also, you know, create other color centers. In fact, there are, you know, a couple of hundred of color center centers known in diamond alone, and I will actually talk later today about other types of defects like silicon vacancies and germanium vacancies. Okay, so but you know, then what one does is once one created these color centers, one just, you know, looks at the under a microscope, and then one can, for example, zoom in on one of these color centers and basically do spectroscopy, and it really looks like, you know, this defect has a discrete level structure, very much like an atom. And one can then use light not only to isolate these individual color centers, but also to manipulate them. So in particular, what one could do, one could use light to spin polarize them through the optical parametric process. You can, even under ambient room temperature conditions, prepare a very pure spin state with an implemented quantum number, for example, m sub s equals 0, and then apply the microwave, and then actually, after you manipulate the spin, you can also use light to read out the spin state of the NB center. And the reason why this is possible is because, depending on the spin state, it turns out that
and this center of fluoresce is either more or less, so it's either brighter or darker. So by looking at this fluorescence, one can actually detect where the NV center is in that M sub s equals 0, M sub s equals 1, or you know, some other state. And so that way, one can use optical technique both to perform electron spin polarization, but and also electron spin detection. And basically, this is one example. It's again, it's very old data where one actually can just perform a radio oscillation experiment on one of these color centers. And what one sees is that, you know, basically this radio oscillation shows up basically as a change in fluorescence, right? And, you know, what you see is that these radio oscillations here are pretty perfect. It's on a tiny scale of you know, just some microsecond. But, for example, the contrast here is not 100%. That means that this readout is possible, but it's not perfect. So this is something that maybe we'll talk a little bit about later in the lecture. So this spin precession at the decay rate for natural diamond, usually, you know, this precession will decay on a time scale of about a microsecond. And actually, the main reason for this decoherence turns out to be nuclear spins, which are kind of, so they're, in particular, carbon has natural abundance. Carbon has about 1% of spinful nuclei which has spin one half, carbon 13, and actually this the presence of this nuclear spin impurities, you know, can explain this, microsecond decay. Now, but one thing, and okay, so that's kind of, you know, basic introduction to NV center physics. Let me maybe pause here and ask if there are any questions. Does it all make sense?
Why is minus one state higher than zero state?
So, yeah, that's actually, okay. That's a very good. So basically, so one could ask the question, so why, you know, what causes, you know, why are these states split at all, right? So there are two reasons. So first of all, if you apply a magnetic field, of course, you know, there will be Zeeman splitting. That's very clear, but actually it turns out even in the absence of the Zeeman splitting, at a zero magnetic field, the states are split, and the splitting is actually close to this 2.87 gigahertz. So the reason why this is the case is actually somewhat subtle, and this has something to do with the fact that the NV center wave function does not have a spherical symmetry. So remember, so in this kind of this NV center is basically right, it's, you know, it's kind of, it's created around this kind of NV axis. So if anything, it actually has some kind of axial symmetry. And so what happens is that if you take two spins, right, two electrons, which have spin one half, and basically, you know, put it into this kind of wave function which doesn't have spherical symmetry, then what will happen is that, for example, if you look at dipole-dipole interaction between these two, this dipole-dipole interaction will not average to zero, right? So remember, if you have dipole-dipole interaction, if you just kind of averages over spherically symmetric volume, this will give rise to zero. If you average non-spherically symmetric volume, it will be non-zero. So actually, kind of, most of this splitting, it turns out, can be understood as resulting from this dipole-dipole interaction between two, dipolar interaction between two electrons in this non-spherically symmetric wave function, right? And so basically, this causes a shift of about 2.8 gigahertz. And this shift actually also slightly depends on other parameters like temperature a little bit. Also depends on strain, but to a leading order it's like a vacuum tension. Any other questions?
All right, so, okay, so at this point one could say, okay, so there is this kind of this spin precession decays on time scale of microsecond, you know, this actually, it's not too bad, you know, but maybe there is nothing you can do about it. It actually turns out that this is not so. So in particular, this nuclear spin environment is a very special kind of environment which itself has a very long memory time. And so what one could do is one could, for example, use things like spin echo to decouple it. And so when you apply, you know, spin echo pulses, you can actually extend this spin coherence time from this value of what's called T2 star to the value of T2, which is more like a millisecond. Moreover, it turns out that, you know, once you realize that your environment consists of kind of long-lived objects, you could think about really trying to use these objects. And so in particular, we and others have done experiments where basically in a diamond sample, you can basically use this carbon 13 nuclear spins around the NV center as qubits themselves. So the idea here is that you basically use NV center as a kind of actuator, which, you know, which is used to read out and create spin polarization, but then you can transfer the spin polarization, for example, to this nearby carbon 13 nuclear spins. And also you can manipulate them, you know, manipulate the interaction between NV center and this carbon 13, and basically use this entire system of NV center with few nuclear spins around it as a one single quantum register. And so using this kind of approach, one could, for example, you know, create long-lived memory. So, like, so for example, under room temperature conditions, you can create a quantum memory which lives for several seconds using this carbon 13 nuclear spins, because they're extremely isolated, you know, from the environment. And then one could also use this quantum registers to perform some small quantum algorithm, like quantum error correction. So. I was actually kind of hoping that Paula will talk about it, but I'm not so sure she's coming or is not around looking something. And guys, I can give you some references to look at it. But you understand the idea, basically. So, but actually, it turns out that once you sort of realize that this kind of nuclear spins can be used as a resource, you could also ask, you know, different types of questions. You can say, okay, so if you can really use this NV center to sense nuclear spins inside diamond, then you also think about using it to sense nuclear spins outside of the diamond. And that brings up some kind of important connection between quantum information and quantum metrology. So in fact, these two kind of subjects really kind of go hand in hand. So usually, if you improve quantum information systems, it actually results in better metrological tools. So if you improve quantum metrological tools, it becomes, they actually improve quantum information systems. And so it turns out that, you know, this kind of idea that you can use this NV center to probe the nuclear spins in its surrounding can actually be much more general. In fact, can be used to, you know, for sensing applications, to sense, you know, some perturbations outside of the diamond. In fact, you know, in the last 10 years or so, it really kind of emerged as a very powerful kind of platform to for nanoscale sensing applications in particular. It actually allows one to really do kind of nuclear magnetic resonance or magnetic resonance imaging at a unprecedented kind of scales, you know, all the way down to individual molecules, and, you know, probe, and kind of this can be used as a probe for new materials and surfaces, for, you know, biological systems. And in fact, you know, there are now efforts to even commercialize these technologies to for kind of biomedical diagnostics. So what I thought I'll do is I'll talk a little bit about this kind of sensing kind of application, and you will see some connection here between kind of this work and also between the quantum information work involving kind of manipulating nuclear spins. So just to kind of give you a little bit of a sense, you know, what this work is about. So you all have heard about nuclear magnetic resonance and magnetic resonance imaging. And the resolution of clinical NMR now is around kind of 1 millimeter. So this clinical NMR, you know, typically involves these kind of big machines, you know, multi-million dollar machines, which, however, allow, you know, doctors and researchers to really kind of look deep inside kind of the, you know, humans and other objects, right, that no other techniques can do. So for the last, you know, 60 years, there has been kind of an idea of trying to really push the limits of this NMR and MRI down to smaller and smaller scale. And in fact, even conventional NMR can be actually miniaturized quite dramatically down to kind of some like 100 micrometer resolution, at which point, you know, you are basically end up sensing something like 10 to 12 nuclear spins. So there are some other exotic techniques, for example, magnetic resonance force microscopy. I don't know if you've heard about it, but it's basically the idea is that you use a kind of you know, cantilever which has a magnetized tip, and you basically, you know, by bringing it closer to the magnetic objects, you see how this kind of frequency of a cantilever changes. Actually, very cool, I mean, very heroic experiments, I must say. But you know, so they brought the resolution down to 100 nanometers. You know, this actually, this cantilever naturally has to be cryogenic, right, if you want to really see small changes. But so over the last kind of 5 years or so, these techniques involving the use of and these centers actually allowed us to kind of bring the resolution to sub nanometer level, and in fact, you know, even allow us to actually look at basically make, you know, images with a single atom kind of resolution, you know, basically images where we can really see identify individual atoms. So what are the two key ingredients for these techniques? So one of them is the use of this the so-called dynamical decoupling sequences. So this is like a kind of sequences like spin echo that I discussed yesterday. So it very much is related to this kind of idea where you have, you know, some very special environment. You know, you have an environment which, for example, has some certain, you know, kind of, you know, spectrum which has peaks at certain frequencies. So what you would like to do here, you would like to basically do spectroscopy of this environment. Okay? And so what I told you yesterday is that, for example, if you have a some kind of, you know, environment which is slowly varying, right? One way to decouple it is to basically just apply the spin echo sequence, right? Which basically time reverses the evolution and cancels the phase. But imagine now you have an environment which for example has very narrow spectrum. So for example, suppose the environment changes periodically in time at certain frequency. And so that's this, for example, for the case when we do this nuclear magnetic resonance experiments. So we have some spins which precess at certain frequency, which is given by Larmor precession frequency of certain type of nuclei. Right? So in this case, what we would like to do, we would like to make the NV center behave such that it actually is not sensitive to any frequencies except for this one specific frequency. And to this one specific frequency, it has to be exclusively sensitive. So the way how to achieve that is to basically apply to subject NV center to a microwave field such that it basically synchronizes the precession of the electronic spin of the sensor to the precession of the, you know, of the nuclear spin that you are trying to detect, right? So in other words, what you do, you basically, you apply, you know, pi pulses to the, so what you do, you set the electron spin to precess, right? Then you interrogate it with the pi pulses such that
the period of the pi pulses basically roughly matches the period of this field that you want to detect. So in this case, the resulting kind of evolution of your electron spin will be pretty much insensitive to everything except for this one, this nuclear field that you are trying to detect. And so, and then basically what you do is very simple experiment where you, you know, polarize the electronic spin, set a precession, and interrogate it with these pulses. And you know, often we apply, you know, thousands of pulses, and then you know, at the end kind of read it out. And then by changing the frequency of this pulse, you can actually use this, then use qubit as a kind of spectrum analyzer. You can really, you know, try to sense a precession at different frequencies. And then the second very important ingredient is that basically what you need to do to be sensitive to a small number of nuclear spins, you need to basically bring your sensor, in this case a mid center, in a direct proximity to the to the sensing target. And so in practice, what this often means is that we work with the NV centers, which are just few nanometers, you know, like 3, 4, 5 nanometers below the surface of the diamond. And so, like with like these two ingredients, what one can do is one can actually look how sensitive you are, how many, for example, proton spins you can detect on the diamond surface. And what you see is basically, like, you know, just starting with plain kind of diamond and just using NV centers, like using the techniques how we discussed them, you can be sensitive to about maybe 100 or so spins. But actually, if you really work hard and basically very carefully control the surface of diamond and also use some tricks, like, for example, improved readout using, you know, quantum non-demolition measurement detection. Well, to that too much, you can basically push these techniques all the way to sense kind of, you know, essentially individual proton spins. What I'd like to do now is I just would like to kind of illustrate, you know, how this technique works, just with one very simple but also very recent example, in which we use it to look at two-dimensional materials locally. So the two-dimensional materials, you guys probably heard about things like graphene, right? Is a, you know, the material which is so-called van der Waals material, where you can really peel it layer by layer. But actually, it turns out graphene is just one example of the big class of materials, and some of them are so, you know, graphene is this kind of, you know, strange kind of metal, right? It's, you know, this has a Dirac point and things like this. So. But for example, there are also materials which are purely kind of insulating materials, or materials which are also semiconductor materials. So you can, there is a broad class of these, and it's a very active field. And so what like nice thing is that here you can just peel them layer by layer, and then what we kind of decided to do is just to use the recenters kind of to look at nuclear spins on these materials and see how materials properties change when you start doing this peeling process. So basically, you know, kind of our idea is to just, you know, deposit one of these kind of flakes on a diamond, and then, you know, by removing this, you know, kind of layers one by one and looking at NMR signal, just try to detect what changes basically. And so here is and of course, the hope is that we should be able to really look at these materials all the way down to a single atom level, right? Because we have this very localized, very sensitive probe. So, okay, so here is the recent experiment that we have done. So basically, where we have an NV center, and on the top of that, we put a flake of this hexagonal boron nitride. So this actually is a this an insulator. And what we then do is we basically just use NV center to look at, for example, boron 11 atoms in this HBM. And basically, you know, that's how the experiment looks like. So this is diamond surface. So there are these, we're shallow these implanted here, and this is a kind of microwave waveguide which we basically use to just provide microwaves to manipulate NV center.
And then what we can do is we can just perform this kind of experiment, this kind of frequency with which we apply pulses, and then what we see is we can very easily identify, for example, kind of resonances associated with this boron 11 atoms precession. And then what we can do is, for example, just, you know, starting from this point, you know, starting, you know, basically peel the layers one by one. And what we see is that as we kind of create thinner and thinner structures, in particular, if we go down to monolayer, we can see, you know, some shift in resonance frequency of this boron atoms. And so basically at this point, you know, basically we look at signals which originates from a very small number, like 10 or so, of this boron atom, so it's really kind of, you know, NMR from very small group of atoms, and this kind of this resonance, you know, this resonance shift is also pretty small, just 0.6%. It actually turns out it originates from modified atomic potentials. So even both these materials are supposed to be layered materials, that is, the interaction between layers is very small. Nevertheless, there is still a residual interaction. So basically, when you start peeling these materials, you know, layer by layer, all the way down to a single layer, what happens is that the electrons basically rearrange a little bit, and this rearrangement is exactly what we can detect. And to kind of explain, it turns out one can really push the kind of envelope on this density functional theory. It's a theory to calculate the, you know, ground state properties of the systems, which actually then is in agreement with this change. Okay, so this kind of, you know, shows you a little bit maybe of a taste or a flavor of the kind of work which is, you know, being done in this area. So in fact, this specific direction we are actually now trying to use this technique to probe magnetism in 2D materials, look at kind of new phenomena in this condensed matter systems. We are also trying to kind of push these techniques to really perform individual addressing and quantum control of these nuclear spins and 2D materials. Right? Like, much like I told you about this carbon-13 nuclear spins in diamond. So we now are in a position where we can really try to kind of couple to individual spins in this, for example, HBM to boron spins. And in fact, one exciting direction is to start kind of, you know, thinking about this kind of nuclear spins and to the materials as a resource. So, for example, they have actually pretty long coherence times themselves, and they're interacting. And so, for example, there have been proposals how to make a quantum simulators based on this kind of systems. So, are there any questions?
Is there a frequency limit to the spectroscopy that you could do with an Edmondson? Doing measurement rates of a megahertz or so, can you go much higher, much lower?
So do you mean the resolution or more like the actual frequencies which you can measure?
The measurement frequencies.
So, so it's a very good question. So, kind of on a high frequency side, so basically, and on a, so there are cost limits on both sides. So on a high frequency side, I guess here one relies on the fact that these nuclei are processing slower than in the center itself. And what I mentioned is that under ambient conditions, at zero magnetic field, the NV splitting is about, you know, 3 gigahertz. Right? That's kind of a natural frequency, you know, which is kind of the highest, you know, frequency. So actually, it turns out one can push this frequency a bit high by applying magnetic field. You can, you know, basically manipulate it, but, you know, it's kind of, okay, on the high frequency side, will be a few gigahertz. So on a low frequency side, the kind of frequencies you can detect is at the end limited by T2 time of your sensor,
which is in this case an E center, and so which would correspond to frequencies, so kind of milliseconds, so it's maybe kind of a kilohertz, you know. So initially, or the technique which I showed you would also be limited in resolution to kilohertz, which is actually maybe not so great, because you know some of the, for example, you know, to kind of identify, you know, molecules, you like to often measure shifts which are down to hertz levels. It actually turns out that one can use a kind of a variety of techniques to push down the resolution to actually sub hertz level also. But I would say the operating frequency range is maybe from kind of at least at room temperature, from kilohertz to maybe kind of a few kilohertz. Yeah.
Might be a pretty random question, yeah. But to me, it looks like the signal is a little cleaner for the 10 layers than the mono layers.
Yes, yes.
Is there a correspondence between?
Yes, because, yes, and the reason for that is very clear. For 10, okay, so basically, the way how these things work is the following. So basically, so in this center here sits, you know, in this case, maybe a few nanometers, like, you know, 3-4 nanometers beneath the surface of diamond.
Yes.
And this distance to the surface is basically determines effectively a sensing volume, right? Everything, you know, within 3-4 nanometers couples similarly to the NV center. What this means is that if you put, for example, a thick flake of, say, 10 layers, so all of these 10 layers will contribute to the signal. So what it means is simply the signal is the 10 times larger. Right, and that's, I think, what is done probably on this plot is, you know, it's a plotted one. It's contrast, so it's kind of normalized.
Yeah.
So it means it's just the signal to noise is a lot like it's factor of 10 larger. That's exactly what it is.
Okay.
Any other questions? All right, so, yeah.
I don't see any error bars here.
Yes, that's very absorbent. So, well, actually, to estimate the error bars, you can just look at the scatter, and so that gives you a sense
what are the.
So this kind of this kind of scatter shows you what the error bar.
And of course, it's determined by averaging. Right?
So these, you know, for these specific experiments, it required multi hours of averaging, but they're at the same time extremely stable, because once you put this flake, nothing moves around. So.
What types of treatments do you use on the surface, or how do you prepare the sample?
So this is also an extremely good question, and the reason why this is important is that, so suppose you have a magnetic, and this center is a magnetic sensor, and you bring it close to the surface, and then the first thing it starts probing is all sorts of surface junk, right? So in this case, it's a magnetic sensor, so kind of electrically, surfaces are much worse than magnetically. But nevertheless, for the just nominally clean diamond surfaces, kind of under ambient conditions, we certainly see that if we come, if we center closer and closer to surface, we start absorbing more and more magnetic noise. So we actually spent several years studying this noise. We've kind of some success, and actually it turns out that at least a big part of this noise is due to localized spins. And these spins are basically corresponding to kind of dangling bonds, unpaired carbon, kind of carbon bonds, which result in kind of local impurities, which kind of look like radicals. Now you would think, well, these kind of radicals are if you expose a sample to air, they will be immediately kind of reactive and so on. So it's actually, it turns out, only partially true. So it turns out some of these radicals are extremely stable. In fact, you know, we were even able to image individual radicals on diamond surface. We were able to image single spins sitting on diamond surface, and these spins can be actually very stable and live for a very long time. So it's actually kind of the cause why these are so stable is still a little bit mysterious, but it actually appears that these very stable radicals live kind of in a little atomic scale crevices. That's a little bit of material science, sorry, but you know, it's basically if you have like atomic scale, a scaling scale, atomic scale step, then in the kind of edge of the step, you can have a radical which can be stable for weeks, and we even have coherence, reasonable coherence times, actually, spin coherence times. But anyway, so if we want to really, like, this is actually fascinating physics on its own, right? But if we just want to get rid of that, the recipe that we developed to kind of eliminate these dangling ones is the recipe which uses oxygen annealing. So what we do, we basically anneal diamond samples in oxygen at like temperature between 400 and 500 degrees. And basically what this oxygen anneal does, it kind of saturates these unpaired spins and it improves. And that's part and that's actually, you know, why we can do experiments like this now. So, very good questions. All right, so let me now, in my last 15 minutes or so, come back a little bit to quantum information science and tell you a little bit about the efforts which are now underway to try to scale things up using a recenter. So what I've shown you that a recenter itself can be kind of a very good qubit, and actually by using nuclei which are surrounding this recenter, one can also create a kind of stable register. But at the end, this register will be limited to a small number of qubits, you know, and this number can for sure be 5, perhaps it can be 10, but you know, it's unlikely it can be much more than that. So what we need to do to really scale this system up is to make these centers talk to each other. And there are several directions which are being pursued, so I will talk a little bit about making this kind of photonic interfaces, basically creating entanglement and quantum logic. Distant emitters. There are also efforts to use phonons to couple and these centers together. And finally, one can also think about coupling these centers to each other using just direct dipolar interaction. So all of these efforts are being actively pursued. I will focus now on this first one, in photonic interface. So the idea of this photonic interface is the following. So basically, use this, electronic spin and maybe a few proximal nuclei as a kind of stationary register, and then to connect this register, we use photons. We use photons to couple them to each other. And this is very much in speed similar to, for example, superconducting qubits, to what Steve will be telling you about. Also, it's very similar to efforts in ions, and I think later in this school, Chris Monroe will give you, I think, some detailed lectures about how to use this kind of probabilistic entanglement between ions to actually scale systems up. So in fact, this work on making V registers interact, you know, using photons was very much, for at least for us, a kind of the motivation to actually start working with NV centers. This work was very much inspired by Chris's experiments. In fact, you all probably have heard about experiments in Delft, which where they use these techniques to entangle NV centers, which were separated by more than 1 kilometer, and actually this was the first experiment demonstrating loophole and equality violation. So one of the people who kind of built this experiment, Hannes Bernier, is actually a postdoc in my group. And when he came, he's kind of here is very happy, you know. So, but you know, when he came, he actually refused to work on any kind of color center experiments. And So I will tell about the work he's doing actually later in the afternoon today. But the reason why he refused to work on his experiments is that, as Chris will tell you, these experiments kind of involving this probabilistic entanglement of stationary qubits are kind of funky because they work well when they work, but they don't work very often. And the reason is that usually, like what you do, you know, in this experiment, you try to kind of excite, for example, two ions or two MB centers and collect the photons which they emit. And, you know, most of the time you don't collect these photons. Most photons are just, you know, lost somewhere. And then, but then basically what you do, you repeat this experiment many, many times, you know, and then once in a while, you know, you actually, you know, get the click. When you get a click in the middle, you know that you entangle these two emitters. And so the self-experiment that resulted in this kind of, rate of one entangled spin pair per hour, and in fact, the entire claim here was based on something like 200 successful events. So it's actually a serious kind of limitation. So we should be able to do better in order to kind of learn how to do better. We need to kind of study a little bit the physics of atom-photon interactions, which already was kind of very nicely introduced by Steve. In case you're interested, you should have a look at chapter 9 of the lecture notes. But kind of the very basic model, the approach here is to essentially put these emitters inside some kind of cavity, right, and control, you know, the interaction between the emitter and the photon. And basically, in this kind of situation, what we end up dealing with is the problem where you basically have, you know, a bosonic mold and one or two few level atoms. Just one few level atom inside this kind of cavity structure. So, what are the basic ingredients of this? Situation. So the key features here is a Hamiltonian which allows for the excitation exchange between this atom and this bosonic mold. So this is the so-called James Cummings Hamiltonian, where basically, you know, which you already have seen here. So where the photon can be annihilated, the atom can be excited, and vice versa. And one of the things which is actually very, very important is the rate at which this process happens. So this coupling constant G is this atom field interaction strength. And this is actually a number four thing that you need to know very, very well. So this G is basically effectively a single photon Rabi frequency. So that's, if you create one photon in a cavity and let this one photon basically interact with atom, so the rate of excitation exchange will be given by G. Now, you have all heard about it, right? James Cummings model, right? Is there anyone who did not hear about it previously? So everyone heard about it. Now the question is, if you are woken up at 3 o'clock, can you tell me what this G is going to be? Where does this G come from? What's a physical intuition? Behind this G. Does anyone know how to derive this G on a... I cannot remember, it's too many symbols here.
The dipole moment, is it?
Huh?
Dipole moment?
It's proportional to dipole moment, so mu is a dipole moment, right? That's good, but then what about this other stuff? This frequency of photon, then V is the mode volume of the cavity. Where does it all come from? Okay, so number four, concept is single photon frequency. what's the physical meaning, where does it come from? Okay, so let's try to derive it. So, okay, so what do we know? We know that we have one photon activity. Yeah?
Change the bar completely.
So we know that we have one photon activity, right? So one photon by definition has energy h bar omega, right? So what we need, so what's a Rabi frequency in general? So Rabi frequency is a product of dipole matrix element times electric field, right? So we are dealing with electric dipole transitions, right? So what we need, therefore, we need to find the electric field associated with this one photon stored in activity. Right? So what, and one way to do it is basically equate this energy to the kind of energy of the field, which is confined in the volume V. So the energy of the electric field will be given by the energy density, zero times E squared, multiplied by the volume, right? That's energy density times the volume is energy. So from here, we can immediately find the electric field per photon, which will be given by something like H bar omega over epsilon zero V, right? And from here, what we can immediately find this single photon radio frequency. So that's the intuition behind it. Right? So basically, the tighter you squeeze your photon, the smaller is the V, the higher is E, and the higher is G. The higher is the frequency, the larger is the frequency, the more energy is in one photon, the higher is G. Right. So this is one of the, and so basically if you want to deal with, like, if you want to ever work with something which involves quantized electromagnetic field, this is the concept that you really need to know. A couple more things which are, play a big role here. You know, one of them is that you, of course, so G is basically a rate of coherent exchange between photon and atom. But of course, the photon in the cavity does not live forever; it will eventually leak out. So this is a photon carried from the cavity is kappa. And then also, you know, at least in optics, you cannot confine all modes. So there are always modes which are unconfined, which means that the atom can interact with modes in free space, and these modes will eventually decay, right? And this is this free space decay rate from atom gamma. Okay, so with all of these kind of, you know, key ingredients, what we can do is we can now analyze the two important regimes of what's called cavity quantum electrodynamics. So there are two regimes which people often talk about. One is the so-called strong coupling regime. So one regime is where G is much larger than any of these, you know, kappa and gamma, any of these incoherent decay processes. So this is the regime, for example, that where circuit QD and this G is there very large, and basically kappa and gamma are kind of on the same order, you know. So this is the regime that, you know, Steve's lectures are covering. Actually, in optics, especially in nanophotonics, often this kappa is the largest energy scale in the problem. So basically, when a photon is created, it very rapidly leaves the cavity. You could say, well, in this case, you know, it's kind of all bets are off. It's kind of not really coherent anymore. But actually, it's not so. So it turns out that even in this regime, you can actually have pretty much full control over atom-photon interactions. So, and the way how to understand this regime is to go back to the rule number 2 out of the 5 things that you need to know.
So I'll ask a follow-up question. So suppose you have now an atom in a cavity which is excited, and there are now four photons initially, and suppose now you start the atom photon interaction starts and it basically produces one excitation, one cavity photon. So now this cavity photon will actually decay with the rate kappa. So in this case, you know what we need to do? We need to use this kind of golden rule, optical pumping type of argument. So in this case, what will happen is that, you know, the combination of this coherent coupling and the photon decay from the cavity will result in effective decay of the atom, which will go like g squared over kappa. Right? Remember from yesterday? Remember? And basically what we need to do now is to basically compare this number with just free space atom decay. So when atom decays in a free space, the photon, you know, goes away, you know, and it's lost. In this case, if we have built the system correctly, what will happen is that the photon will not be lost, but instead will, you know, go outside of the cavity and can be collected, for example, using a fiber or something like this. So basically, you know, what this analysis shows is that, you know, cavity will dominate in this regime, in the so-called Purcell regime, where g squared over kappa gamma is much, much larger than one. So what is it, you know, and so basically this is the so-called Purcell condition, and this this ratio of g over kappa gamma can actually be expressed in terms of a couple of different ways. So one thing to note is that both g squared and gamma depend on electric dipole moment of the atom, but actually this dependence is exactly the same. Remember, g is proportional to a dipole moment, and g squared is proportional to a square of a dipole moment. Actually, gamma, spontaneous emission decay, also proportional to the square of the dipole moment. So the dipole moment cancels out, it turns out. But actually, but what remains is just, you know, a few factors. So first of all, the mode volume of the cavity remains. The wavelength, just by dimensionality, remains because of frequency dependence, and also Q of the cavity, the quality factor of the cavity, which is basically what's the kind of lifetime of the cavity compared to its frequency. Or alternatively, this can be written as this kind of lambda over d times the cavity finesse. So let me just kind of, you know, explain this from a very different perspective. So here, what we could say is the following. So let's now just, you know, forget about this quantum description for a second. Just let's think about things classically. Let's just consider the propagation of the focused photon laser beam through the cloud of atoms. Let's just ask, what's the probability of single photon, single atom interaction? This probability can be actually written as a ratio of the absorption cross-section of the atom divided by the transverse localization of the photon. Right? So basically, in this case, this photon propagation is like a flow of water in a pipe. Right? I mean, you can just some targets, which are atoms, which try to block this flow of water. And you know, one could ask the question is, what's the largest resonant absorption cross-section probability that you can get? Actually, it turns out that the largest probability you can get at resonance is given by the wavelength squared, right? So remember Landau-Lifshitz optical theorem? This is for any process, for any scattering process, the largest probability of scattering at resonance is given by a wavelength. Cannot be for the small scatterer, right? Scatterer is huge, right? Then it's different. So so this is the largest interaction probability, which of course, you know, in practice usually is much smaller than one. So it also means that if you want, you know, this photon to be absorbed, you need a certain number of atoms which will scale inversely from that. But so what we do now is we add some kind of cavity around it. So what this cavity does, it actually makes this photon bounce inside this cavity, you know, go back and forth a few times. And the number of bounces is this thing which is called cavity finesse. Cavity finesse is just the number that the photon bounces before it escapes. So if you basically So what we need to do now, we just need to multiply this lambda squared over d squared by this number of bounces. And so what will to be large, this precisely is this figure of merit, this g squared over kappa gamma, which I derived previously. So in fact, you know, this is what's called cavity cooperativity in cavity QD. So this cooperativity is basically defined as g squared over kappa gamma. Or alternatively, it can be written as this lambda squared over d times thinness. Or alternatively, it can be written as this product of the cavity cube times lambda cubed over d. So these are all equivalent definitions of cooperativity. Okay, so basically this is kind of the family of what you know, I've discussed so far. So in this kind of Purcell regime, the figure of merit is a cavity cooperativity. And the important thing is that this cooperativity scales inversely with the mode volume of the cavity. So the approach, which I will then obviously talk to you later in the afternoon today, which we now are realizing, involves kind of entering this regime where cooperativity is much larger than one by essentially shrinking down the this volume of the cavity by making the cavity very, very small, such that to increase the electric field per photon. And so this is basically kind of this approach, which we call integrated quantum nanophotonics, where basically we start with the some waveguides or some cavities which can confine light at the subwave velocity. So this is one example of that. So this is the so-called 1D photonic waveguide. So it's basically a thin dielectric wire which has some holes in it. And what these holes do, so the thin dielectric wire guides light in this transverse direction, along this confines light in transverse direction, guides light along this this wire. And then these holes, what they do, they basically cause the photons to be kind of reflected all the time, right? And basically, they can be used to create photonic crystals or photonic band gaps, you know, things like this. But this is basically just a broad kind of mirror. And then what we're trying to do is we're trying to put emitters, you know, either gold atoms or what I will tell you about in the color centers, you know, in the direct proximity of this kind of system, such that there's a strong coupling between confined light and these color centers. Okay, I think I've used up my time, so thank you very much.
Thank you. It's already a huge improvement over yesterday. Number of questions.
That's right.
More?
Any other questions about this? This introductory QD?
If not, what I would encourage is we're going to take a few minute break, is that for you to come forward.